Hey everybody, it's Master Gallengeist here, bringing you my review of the anime movie My Hero Academia, Heroes Rising. And I really enjoyed this movie. Granted, it follows more along the lines of kind of being that non-canon approach, but it is somewhere along the timeline of Season 4 that is still going on right now, but it doesn't really have any kind of spoiler things or anything going on. I mean, you don't even have to really have watched Season 4 to really watch this, so if you're like, I don't want anything spoiled, don't worry, you're good with that. I'm still watching Season 4 as it's coming on Toonami and all that, and I really enjoyed this. It was a nice little thing that kind of gave the whole class pretty much a chance to shine, and now granted, I thought that the villains needed to have at least a little bit more characterization done on them and some character development, because I mean they do have a goal, but you don't really get that much into all the characters, mainly just the head villain of Nine. So we open up with this car chase as we see that the League of Villains have someone in this kind of like contraption for like life support or whatnot, and it's pretty cool. We get to see all these different kind of heroes doing their kind of thing. We see Rock Lock and everything, and Endeavor is the one that stops the vehicle. The League's able to get out, but the person that was in there escaped. And we see that this is Nine. He's like, all right, let's do my plan, pretty much getting up with his homies and get ready to do their thing. Well, that's kind of where they're left off for the moment. Then we go and we see, hey, what's Class 1A doing? Well, we see that they are essentially running their own kind of hero agency on this island, Nabu Island, because their hero that they had retired, and actually I think it's both a good idea and a bad idea. They're pretty much just left to their own devices and are doing their own hero work and everything. Now granted, it's just kind of like lower level things, but it's really kind of nice to see them using their powers in different kind of situations. We see Deku, of course, using his and the help doing certain and different kind of tasks around the island. It just kind of like works out because it's not the usual kind of like punch, punch, kick, kick, which we do get to eventually, but it's kind of cool to see them working together. Bakugo like not giving a crap and being kind of like, this isn't what I'm here for, pretty much. And him kind of getting short shafted would be like, yeah, you get night patrol because you didn't do anything all day. But it kind of works out. We see that there's this like pair of brother and sister, let's see here, Kasuma and Maharo, and Maharo is the bigger sister and pretty much trying to show her little brother that heroes suck and that he shouldn't be a hero, but he also kind of has that kind of anxiety because he wants to be a hero, but his quirk doesn't really lend itself for him to being a hero. So that's where we see that Deku kind of works into the equation, where Mahara's trying to be like, this kid sucks. It's like, oh, I'm just glad you're okay, kid. No problems or anything. And of course, Kasuma is like, he feels bad because every time his sister tries to do this to show that heroes kind of suck, it kind of backfires because, well, Deku's able to find him. And even though she's like berating him for being quote unquote late or taking too long, he's just like, that's fine, yeah, I'll do better next time. They, of course, tried kind of the same thing on Bakugo. Well, it wasn't intentionally supposed to have Bakugo drawn into it. It was, again, mainly to be done to Deku. But, of course, once you get Bakugo in the mix, we find out that Maharo's quirk is using illusions and everything. And Bakugo is, of course, pissed off about this and pretty much tells him not to fucking do that again. And, of course, Deku's trying to be like, calm down, Bakugo. Jesus Christ, they're kids. And he's, like, getting ready to, like, blast them and stuff. I'm like, ooh. Well, he doesn't go that far, but he did use his blast to, like, find the little girl. It's like, holy shit. While this is going on, we see that Nine has decided to go after these kids' father because he's going off to have work and everything. And we see that he has the ability to steal quirks. Nine. And he has been upgraded to essentially have one for all's ability to steal quirks, and he can control like 9 quirks at one time. But the thing is, overuse of the quirks degrades his body, and we see that he tries to steal this dude's quirk for a reason, doesn't work on his blood type. So he's like, hey, I need to go for those kids. So we get a little bit through, and they start their initial attack on the island. They're able to pretty much take out, well, they do this fairly effectively, and they go and they take out communications and everything. Now, this is where we get into the part of like, yeah, it's kind of, I understand that you're trying to get these kids to have training and experience and everything, and you thought, hey, this shouldn't go wrong at all. Villains kind of gravitate toward this class, so I'm like, you are sending these kids off with no adult supervision and no adult backup whatsoever. Okay, that's kind of one of my issues, but it doesn't really detract from my enjoyment as much as I thought it would, but it is still there to be like, yeah, they could have done something a little bit better. Maybe have retired heroes on there as well to kind of like, I don't know, make it a little bit more plausible and not just like, yeah, these kids have been like attacked by the League of Villains. A couple of them were involved in other kind of villain attacks and all that. We kind of might want to have some backup on them and maybe not like completely devote a lot of heroes to it, but maybe some heroes that want to feel useful and everything and actually do something. Be like, hey, yeah, I don't care that we're like essentially babysitting or backing up people. That's fine. You're helping train the generation of heroes. But we see that Class 1A has, they're kind of head on right. We see that the villains kind of go out. They kind of have some trouble with the mummy dude, which was an interesting quirk because he was able to subdue Bakugo pretty well, but then Bakugo's like, eat me! And blasts out and pretty much takes his ass out. I'm like, okay. We see that the Slice kind of gets screwed over. She's essentially like a Medusa analog from Marvel, where she could use her hair to like fire stuff and everything. She kind of doesn't do much in the beginning of the attack and kind of gets screwed over as she's like pretty much one of the pillars. It's really kind of strange. I wish more had been done with her character because I'm like, you essentially got these four apocalyptic kind of figures because Nine wants to make a world where the strong rule over the weak. Okay, I'm good with that. Pretty good motivation. Go with that. But the rest of them is like, okay, Mummy gets like knackered out, but he has at least some fighting, and they're able to capture him. A group of the students fight Chimera, and his strength is too off the charts to do anything with. It's like, holy shit. And then Nine, of course, blows up the kid's house, tries to go for the kid, Kazuma, and Deku, of course, pops up. He's trying to fight the dude, but of course he finds out he has all these different quirks. He tries to steal Deku's quirk, but of course the nature of One For All does not allow that to occur. He's like, well, I guess I gotta kill you, kid. And Deku's trying to stay at like 20%, and it's really having no effect. And he's pretty much getting beat up because he's able to use laser fingers and everything. Bakugo, of course, tries to help as well, but they get into an effect where Nine is able to use weather-altering powers and does a bolt of lightning that pretty much knocks him out. But, of course, the rest of 1A is able to get some kids in there and get them out and have all the rest of the island dwellers in a kind of, like, factory kind of place, and they're trying to regroup and everything, and we find out that Kazuma's quirk is, like, cellular activation, so it's a healing thing. Pretty much, that would allow Nine to be able to use his power no matter what and screw his body being pretty much destroyed in the process, as we had seen towards the end of his fight with Deku and Bakugo. Of course, Kazuma is able to use his power to heal Deku and Bakugo, and they're able to like come up with a plan. It's like, all right, what we gotta do, there's this other island that's got a castle onto it. It's connected to Nabu Island, and they pretty much funnel them in and then try and split off the rest of the people while Deku and Bakugo's plan is pretty much to take on Nine until he gets to his threshold point where he won't be able to do anything anymore and pretty much end it that way. And this is pretty much where we get towards the end of the film. We then split up between the different kind of fights. The splice fight is, it's not horrendous, but it takes up the smallest chunk of time because they pretty much get to a point where they like go nuts and they're able to pretty much bury her because she gets pissed off because they like take her hair out. She's like, fuck you on that. And they're a Tokoyami's goes nuts, and because one of his teammates is injured, and his quirk goes insane and pretty much buries him. It's like, okay, cool. And of course, while this is going on, one of the other heroes is able to figure out what's going on. It's like, hey, kind of start getting people to go to Naboo Island. I know where he's going. And then we, of course, see the better battle of Chimera with like Todoroki, Ida, and Kirishima, and kind of other heroes as well. That one's, of course, a little bit better. They're trying to figure out what to do with the guy, and he kind of goes completely crazy mode. Like, his quirk is never really explained that much. I mean, he's a very Chimera kind of dude, and he just keeps getting like bigger and like blasting off and having energy blasts, kind of like a kaiju kind of thing. And Todoroki's idea is to pretty much flash freeze him into place. Works, but they get knocked out completely. And of course, Bakugo and Deku are trying their hardest to take on Nine, but even at him going like at 100%, they're not really getting their dents in. And the dude's just like going on. Like, everything they throw at him isn't really, it's not taking him out or getting to the point where he can't move anymore. He even gets to a point where he grabs the little sister and pretty much threatens to kill her if the kid doesn't come at him and come to him to give him his quirk. And the kid's like, screw you! And he's like, I'm going to save my sister. I'm like, there you go, little kid. Going to save your sister. There you go. And she was trying to save him too. But of course, that had given them the ability, because he had used his lightning bolt attack again, but the thing was, they had one of the other heroes, Kaminari, pretty much act as a lightning rod, and Deku pretty much comes in and starts knocking him out. But they get to a point where Bakugo and Deku are really kind of screwed over, and Deku knows that they need to stop this fight no matter what. So he comes up with the idea of passing on One for All to Bakugo and using the last embers of One for All to go to 100%, so that way you got two people using it at once. And that's definitely the hero that Deku is. It didn't surprise me, but I'm like, yeah, he's gonna have to get into a situation to test what it means to be a hero. And he doesn't hesitate at all for it. He's like, this is what will help these people, this is what will protect them, and this is what will save these kids. And Bakugo's like, so it's a nice kind of little thing of, it kind of reminded me a lot of like Goku and Vegeta, where usually Vegeta's the one that like swallows his pride to kind of power up Goku, mainly because Goku's usually the one that would have the greater effect. But it's like, okay, we'd have two people with One for All. It would amp up some of the stuff with Bakugo with his quirk and everything. Let's do it. And Bakugo, we see struggles with that. He's like, shit. But he accepts it, and seeing them both go at 100%, like going after Nine, was really pretty awesome. I like the kind of shift that they did in animation style, because we see some crazy stuff as they're like flying around, Bakugo using his quirk, and it's just like they fuck up this island with what they're doing, but they're going to stop this dude no matter what. And we see that Deku uses what he thinks is going to be his final smash as they take Nine down, and everything's pretty much done. They've taken all the villains out, and we see that the pros have come in to assist, and the military and everything. And it was really kind of cool seeing through the fight, because we see Bakugo having the same kind of injuries that Midoriya would have in the beginning of using One for All, because he's not used to it, his body's not used to it. But we see that All Might pops up, and of course Deku is apologizing to him, because he's like, you made me your successor, and I had to pass it on because that was the only way I saw to win, and being really sorry and everything. All Might, of course, is like, you did what you needed to. And he's looking over at Bakugo and sees that he doesn't have One for All, and then he looks down at Midoriya after he's passed out and sees that he still retains One for All, showing that One for All kind of has a mind of its own, because he thought that Bakugo might have passed out after transferring the quirk back to Deku. But it seems that One for All has its own kind of mind and knows that Midoriya is a worthy successor, and that's really kind of cool. It's like, oh, that's all right. I know that could seem like kind of a cop out of like, oh, Deku made this great sacrifice and it's kind of undone, but not really. He made that choice in the moment, pretty much sure that he would be quirkless, and if they didn't get that shot done with all that power, he would be useless. His job was to make sure that that was done, come hell or high water, if he had a quirk or if he was even a hero after giving off One for All. And he showed why he was worthy of that power and why he should still retain it. It's like, okay, that's kind of a cool little thing to see what that would kind of mean. So we'll have to see if that kind of like pops up in the anime or what repercussions this could potentially have. It's like, okay, because we see him after the aftermath helping the villagers and everything, and Bakugo doesn't even remember having One for All. He's like, why am I injured like this? And everybody's like, all right and cool, as the class leaves on a ship and everything, as Kitsuma and his sister and his father are like saying goodbye and saying that he's going to be a hero as well. Deku and Bakugo giving him words of encouragement, and that's where the movie ends. So I liked it for how its premise was and how it seemed to move along pretty well. It had its nice defined acts. Granted, there were some issues with certain characters not getting really any kind of development, and sometimes just we don't know where they are during the movie at certain instances with like Splice. It's like, okay. But I did like the action that we got at the end and everything, and the character development that we got with Deku and Bakugo, and them just kind of like continuing on their hero's journey. So yeah, I would definitely recommend seeing this if you have a chance to see it in the theaters, or definitely when it comes to any kind of streaming service or anything on like a movie channel or anything like that. It's decent. It's pretty good. Yeah, I don't think you'll have a problem with it. It's it's that kind of in between. I don't know if certain little kids would be okay with it. There's not a copious amount of blood and like sexual things going on, but they could be scared because of the fights or whatnot. But I think anybody who's a fan of action or whatnot, yeah, you'll be good with this. The plot's simple, so you won't really go too deep or have any kind of crazy twists or turns. And there's certain good character developments for like the main heroes, and not so much with the villains. So those are my opinions on the movie. Tell me what you guys think in the comments below. If you liked it, if you didn't like it, if you agree with me, if you disagree with me. Also like and subscribe, and I hope you have a good day.